Hi there. Today we're going to do about 135 years of Regina history in about 14 minutes with a segment I like to call Regina in a Nutshell. Are you ready? Let's go. Before there was a permanent settlement here, Regina was known as Oscana Ka As Astega, or the place where the bones are piled. By 1882, First Nations people had been pushed onto reserves, and non-Indigenous hunters had greatly depleted the once mighty buffalo herds through mass hunts. The bone piles were an effort by Indigenous peoples to honor the animals' spirits. The land where Regina now sits is part of the Treaty 4 area, which was established in 1874. Prior to the treaty's signing, Aboriginal people had followed the buffalo through the area. Regina's lack of reliable water, shelter, or trees made it a poor spot for a permanent settlement. But in 1882, settlers did just that. Why? Because Lieutenant Governor Edgar Dewdney selected the railroad's path and placed the Northwest Territory's new capital near land he owned. This decision was very controversial. Dewdney, in addition to being a land surveyor and politician, was a land speculator. He was also Indian Commissioner during his time as Lieutenant Governor and was instrumental in setting up the reserve system, a legacy which continues to impact Canada's Indigenous peoples. Dewdney answered directly to John A. Macdonald, who was Minister of the Interior as well as Prime Minister. So when Dewdney's land speculation in the Regina area came to light in Parliament, it sparked a major controversy. Other sites with more natural beauty, such as Moose Jaw and Troy, now Qu'Appelle, had been rejected as locations for the capital. Newspapers and politicians at the time speculated that the only reason for selection of Pile of Bones as the capital of Assiniboia was its proximity to Dewdney's own land purchase. The Canadian Pacific Railroad ultimately foiled Dewdney's plan and chose to move the train station closer to what is now Regina's downtown. Dewdney did, however, influence the location of several government buildings. In spite of wild temperature swings, from minus 40 degrees to plus 40 degrees Celsius, people came to the new capital, which didn't yet have a proper name. In late 1882, Princess Louise, daughter of Queen Victoria and wife of Governor General the Marquess of Lorne, suggested naming the new settlement in honor of her mother. Contrary to popular belief, the pronunciation Regina was an acceptable pronunciation of the word, which today is often pronounced Regina in other contexts. Regina almost immediately became the chosen location for the Northwest Mounted Police, now the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. The headquarters was moved to Regina from Fort Walsh in 1882, and the training depot has been located here ever since. This is the origin of three of Regina's nicknames: Pile of Bones, in honor of the original name, Oscana Ka As Astega. Home of the RCMP, in honor of Canada's National Police Force, and the Queen City, in honor of Queen Victoria. In 1883, Regina became the Northwest Territory's capital, including parts of present-day Manitoba, all of Saskatchewan and Alberta, the three Northern Territories, and some of Northern Ontario and Quebec. This is bigger than all of Europe in landmass. People flocked west to live in what was basically a mud hole full of tents. But as people showed up, so did services, including a newspaper, churches, a post office, and schools. Regina became a town on December 1st, 1883. In 1885, anger toward the government among Métis people of the Northwest Territories turned into what became known as the Riel Resistance, or the Northwest Resistance. Louis Riel, who had been instrumental in founding the province of Manitoba, returned to Canada from the United States to form a Métis government at Batoche. The Canadian government answered this with a show of force that stopped the resistance. Riel was captured, tried for treason, and swiftly and controversially executed in Regina on November 16, 1885. Riel's execution remains contentious to this day, and his legacy has shifted drastically from that of a traitor to that of a hero and protector. Regina had a complex and strained relationship with the local Indigenous community at the time of the Riel resistance and after. Regina's connection to the residential school system goes through to one of its earliest pioneers, Nicholas Flood Davin. the founder of the Regina Leader, a poet and a member of Parliament, Davin was also the author of the 1879 Report on Industrial Schools for Indians and Half-Breeds, better known as the Davin Report. This became the blueprint for John A. Macdonald's government as they implemented the residential school system for Indigenous children. The impact on Canada's Aboriginal population was staggering and generational in its scope. Regina was the site of the Regina Indian Industrial School, which was located west of the city near what is now the Paul Dojak Youth Center. This was a Presbyterian institution, part of the residential schools program that devastated First Nations communities around Canada for decades. It operated from 1891 to 1910 and was demolished in 1948. The cemetery for the Regina Indian Industrial School was abandoned and largely forgotten for decades. The city of Regina has just begun grappling with how to put the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Committee into practice. The City of Regina Archives supplied material to the Truth and Reconciliation Commission during its fact-finding, including this image. In March 2016, City Council unanimously committed to acting on the recommendations of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. One of the City of Regina's first steps in this journey was to provide heritage designation to the Regina Indian Industrial School Cemetery site, which took effect in September 2016. In 1903, Regina became a city, partly because Regina had a pressing need for things like running water, sidewalks, paved roads, sewers, and electricity. Jacob W. Smith was our mayor then. We've had 38 different mayors in total. Here are some mayoral highlights. Coolest hair, Walter D. Cowan, who hosted public debates in his dental office. Youngest mayor, Frances N. Dark, buried in Regina's only above-ground mausoleum. Only female mayor to date, Doreen Hamilton, who became mayor thanks to a coin toss when her predecessor, Larry Schneider, resigned to run for federal election. Longest-serving mayor, Henry Baker, who was simultaneously a provincial member of the Legislative Assembly. And the only mayor to fight against Britain in a war, Cornelius Rink, who fought for the Dutch in the Boer War. In 1905, Saskatchewan became a province, and in 1906, Regina became its capital. Back then, Saskatchewan was the fastest-growing province. We still had no trees, though. Once we became the capital, the residents worked on making Regina look less like a flat moonscape. They planted trees, built a legislative building, landscaped parks, and built a city hall. By 1912, Regina looked pretty impressive. On June 30, 1912, Regina became the site of Canada's deadliest tornado when twin funnel clouds tore down two of the most populous streets in the city. 28 people were killed, hundreds injured, and 2,500 people were left homeless. Within a year, most of the city was rebuilt, but it took about 40 years to pay off the debt. When residents returned from World War I, Regina became a pioneer in the field of aviation. It was the home to Canada's first airfield. The first commercial pilot, Roland J. Groom, and the first airplane mechanic, Bob McCombie. One advantage of being flat, featureless, and treeless turned out to be that you can build a nice long runway for airplanes. In World War II, Regina would be the home of RCAF flight schools for Allied pilots, and Regina's runway was so long that it's one of the few locations in Canada where the Concorde was able to land. In the 1930s, Regina suffered the consequences of the Great Depression, which collapsed the economy and led to massive unemployment. Regina hosted two make-work projects, the deepening of Wascana Lake, and the construction of the Albert Memorial Bridge. But the number of unemployed men far outstripped employment opportunities, and by 1935, unemployed men in British Columbia were traveling towards Ottawa, where they intended to demand help. The federal government ordered the On to Ottawa Trek, as it became known, to be halted in Regina because of its RCMP presence. Arrest warrants were issued, and when police moved in to shut down a peaceful rally, the Regina riot broke out. In the end, there were two dead, including one police officer, hundreds were injured, and tens of thousands of dollars in property damage was done to downtown Regina. It wasn't until World War II started that the Great Depression lost its hold over the world. After the end of World War II, Regina started to prosper again. the oil industry flourished. Saskatchewan celebrated its jubilee in 1955, and there was a post-war construction boom. In 1955, the Royal Saskatchewan Museum got a permanent home after having been located in a variety of spots since the first artifact donation in 1906. In 1970, Regina completed construction on the Centre of the Arts, now known as the Kinexus Arts Centre. It gained the nickname the largest monkey bars in the world due to construction delays. In 1990, the Mackenzie Art Gallery moved into its current home in the T.C. Douglas Building. Home to over 3,500 works of art, the Mackenzie can trace its origins back to 1936, when Norman Mackenzie bequeathed a portion of his collection and estate to the University of Saskatchewan for use at Regina College. Most people don't realize it, but Regina is a cultural powerhouse. The Regina Symphony Orchestra is Canada's oldest. Canada's oldest theatre troupe is the Regina Little Theatre. Canada's longest consecutively running play is Regina's The Trial of Louis Riel. And we have a number of famous actors who spent part of their lives in Regina, including Leslie Nielsen, John Vernon, Shirley Douglas, Stephen Yeun, and Tatiana Maslany. Musicians such as opera singer June Kowalski, Feist, Ra-Ra, Library Voices, Jack Semple, and Colin James have called Regina home. Our visual arts community includes Joe Fafard, Bob Boyer, the Regina Five, and Wilf Perot. Regina's literary community includes Ven Begamudri, Gail Bowen, Dave Margoshis, and Ken Mitchell. In the 1970s and 80s, Regina experienced a downtown revitalization, including the Cornwall Center and McCallum Hill Towers buildings. In 1975, Regina played host to the Western Canada Summer Games, which prompted a mini-construction boom connected to sporting facilities, including the Lawson Aquatic Centre. Regina has deep sporting roots. It was a recruiting ground for the All-American Girls Professional Baseball League, including Daisy Junior and Mary Bonnie Baker. Regina has always been hockey territory, including players like Jordan Eberle, Ryan Getzlaff, and Doug Wickenheiser. The Regina Pats are the oldest major junior hockey franchise in the world, operating from their original location under the same name. Our most famous snowboarders are Mark and Craig McMorris. Regina's pretty flat and doesn't have many hills for snowboarding after all, but Regina was home to many famous curlers, including the Richardsons and the Sandra Schmirler Rink. When Canadians think about Regina in sports, however, they think about the Riders. The four-time Grey Cup-winning Canadian Football League franchise started in Regina in 1910 and has been going strong ever since. Saskatchewan Roughrider fans have been described as rabid, obsessive, and rowdy. Those are compliments around here, a place where fans routinely dress for games by putting a watermelon on their heads and playing a banjo. Regina has grown from a tiny settlement to a thriving city of over 195,000 people. Regina has a rich and diverse heritage and population that's becoming more diverse as immigration to the city makes Regina an even greater place to work, live, and raise a family. While Regina may have started as a flat, featureless expanse, we now have over 300,000 hand-planted trees and more than 100 parks. Regina is the sunniest capital city in Canada, even if it is one of the chilliest. That's over 135 years of Regina history in about 14 minutes. Want to learn more? Visit the City of Regina's website at regina.ca to find information about Regina, both past and present.
The museum has had a variety of homes over its history. We are standing outside of the current building, which was built in 1955, and it was part of the celebration of the Jubilee of the province. So that's when the province of Saskatchewan became 50 years old. We have three galleries, and so in the basement of the building, we have our sciences gallery, and it talks about Earth history, so geology. And paleontology, fossils. And we also have a First Nations gallery, which talks about Aboriginal cultures. So we're getting now into the human history. Upstairs, we have the life sciences gallery. We have a series of dioramas which describe the various ecoregions of the province. So a visitor can essentially take a natural history tour of the province by going through that portion. We have a rainforest exhibit which is based on a site in Costa Rica. And so there, visitors will see birds, for example, that they would see in the summer in Saskatchewan, and it would show them in their winter habitat where they migrate south. The last part of the upper gallery is called the human factor, and that's where we really try to get into some topical issues around climate change, effect that our species is having on global ecosystems. So we sort of try and raise awareness. We do some temporary exhibits, and we don't have dedicated a lot of temporary exhibit space in the museum. So what we do is we develop a series of smaller exhibits that can fit into our lobby space. Scotty is Saskatchewan's Tyrannosaurus Rex. He was discovered in the mid-90s. So we've got this is a rather large dinosaur. The skull's about 4 feet long. So yeah, it's a pretty fearsome sight in the gallery there. One of the really popular features of our museum here in Regina is a robotic dinosaur called Megamunch. And he's basically a half-sized T-Rex, so all the dimensions are sort of half of what living size would have been. But extremely popular with the kids. He's robotic, he makes movements and he roars, and so he's a big attraction for us. Certainly we want people to have a sense of the province and in those various subject matter areas that we talked about, get a sense of our history in the sense of our Aboriginal cultures and how those cultures are very much living cultures. So there's a lot of theme there that these are living cultures. We're not talking about the past here entirely, right? In fact, we really try to emphasize the living aspect of that.
Government House was built in 1891, and that was actually back when Saskatchewan was a part of the Northwest Territories in those days, but Regina was the capital city from 1883 on, and so Government House was built as the official residence for the Lieutenant Governor of Saskatchewan to live and work. So being in such a high position, being the representative of the Queen in this province, they had a Victorian mansion built for them. Over the years, it's been at the heart of Saskatchewan history. In 1945, after the end of the Second World War, the Saskatchewan economy wasn't doing well at all. Many people were unemployed. Many people, were hungry, and it seemed so hypocritical to continue paying for this luxury through our tax dollars. And so they vacated the house. So all of the original artifacts and furniture were sold off at an auction in 1945. And then right after that, businesses. They came in, the Department of Veterans Affairs, I should say, came in and painted all the walls white, brought in hospital beds, and it became a convalescent home. So it was a convalescent home for soldiers returning from the war from 1945 to 1957. And then in 1957, it fell into the hands of the Department of Education. And so for the next 20 years, it would actually be an adult education center. So again, they used the space for something else, painted the walls, brought in desks and converted these rooms into classrooms, and it was an adult education center until 1977. So it was sort of at that point, sort of the turning point, when we didn't know what was going to happen to this place. Many people wanted the building to be bulldozed. They believed it was in disrepair and there was no point to, keep it going. And then the majority of people actually believed that it was worth keeping around, considering being the oldest house in Regina. It was a pretty important part of our history. And so they decided to convert it into a museum, so to sort of take things back in time and looking at old photographs that were taken around the time that Saskatchewan became a province in 1905, they did their best to recreate that Victorian / Edwardian time period in the house here. So things like the wallpaper and the carpets on the floors are not original but reproductions, and much of the antique furniture does come from the time period and is more than 100 years old, although it's not necessarily original to the house. But yes, Government House was opened and officially became a museum in 1980, so it was kind of a great turnaround from what could have happened to it. It would have been a shame to lose this this historical gem, I should say.
Mosaic is an important part of our community because it has been the host of so many activities over the past 100 plus years. Great football, great concerts, lots of activity through our city, a community focal point.
Mosaic Stadium is truly representative of the people in this community. It stands tall, it stands proud, just like our citizens do. It's given so much to so many people over the years.
I remember the people, the fans, the cheering fans, best in the CFL.
It's pretty cool to play on the same field as the professional football players.
It makes me happy that I'm here to see like how it feels for them to be here and play for all these people.
I'm gonna miss it so much, but it's time for a new chapter.
Because of that rich history, it's important to remember what happened, what took place, honor that in the farewell season, and then be prepared to move on to a new, dynamic, iconic new stadium.
Welcome to Evraz Place, operated by the Regina Exhibition Association Limited.
Our history is a fascinating one, beginning more than 130 years ago, long before Saskatchewan was even a province.
It all began back in 1884 when an enthusiastic group of townsfolk organized Regina's first ever agricultural fair in what we now know as Victoria Park downtown.
In time, 50 acres of land was purchased west of Elphinstone Street and became the permanent home of the Regina Agricultural and Industrial Exhibition Association. It was only about half the size of the property we manage today.
Known for years as Regina Exhibition Park, we played host to events large and small, including the prestigious World's Grain Exhibition and Conference in 1933, during the heart of the Great Depression.
In 1967, Canada's centennial year, a citywide celebration called Buffalo Days was born. It was a nod to Regina's indigenous roots and our pioneer history. Buffalo Days was such a hit, it carried on for many years after, with Pile of Bones Sunday in Wascana Center and the week-long summer fair at Exhibition Park.
Make no mistake about it, the fair was our crown jewel for many years. But in the 1970s, two other major events were born: Canadian Western Agribition and Canada's Farm Progress Show, both internationally recognized and still hosted on these very grounds today.
The men and women who began all this more than 130 years ago could not have imagined what this park would eventually come to be, or what impact it would have on modern life in the Queen City.
Evraz Place now encompasses over 100 acres, making it the largest interconnected event complex in all of Canada. We're a community gathering place and the center of sport, business, and entertainment, where people come together to enjoy great hospitality at events of every type. And it's a place where new memories are being made every day of the year.
Today, we're the proud home of Mosaic Stadium and the Saskatchewan Roughriders. Brandt Center is the home base for the Regina Pats Hockey Club. The team has played on the property for all of its 100-plus years. We have the impressive Queensbury Convention Center as well, the 90,000-square-foot eventplex with a regulation-size indoor soccer field, the Cooperator Center with a six-rink hockey arena, and the International Trade Center, the new home for Canadian Western Agribition. Major trade shows, conferences, and other events of all shapes and sizes.
Opening ceremony.
The hotel opened on Queen Victoria's birthday, May 24th of 1927, after just 11 months of construction. They broke ground in June of 26, and with 1,000 men working in 24-hour shifts, they were able to open the hotel just 11 months later. Originally, there was a hotel slated to be built on the site of the Royal Saskatchewan Museum. When that construction was halted because of World War I, they took the steel structure from that hotel and used it in the building of this one, and then took the dirt they dug out from here and filled in the hole over there. So, some early repurposing work going on back then. In 1982 or 83, there was a major fire that actually gutted our ballroom. And in the decade following that, there was a lot of work done in the hotel. And then finally, in the early 90s, a major restoration that restored the hotel to its original look. A lot of that work entailed, of course, new carpeting, covering up the marble floors that we do have. They had suffered a lot of wear and tear over the years. Some of the exposed work in the lobby, you can still see the exposed beams and things like that. And the barbershop has the original chairs and sinks that were done there. Where we're standing right now used to have a drop ceiling, and when the restoration work was done, they took the drop ceiling down and discovered these beautiful chandeliers that are hanging there. Somewhere along the way, a previous renovation had just covered them up and hidden them away, and they were forgotten about until the drop ceiling came down, and there they were. Also hidden away by that ceiling were the moldings that you see here, which were originals, and so they were used then to provide patterns in the restoration work in other parts of the hotel. Over the years, we've had Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth a few times. We've also most recently had Prince Charles here just last year. The Queen Mother was here back in the 70s, and other members of the royal family, Prince Edward, Prince Andrew, Princess Margaret, Princess Anne. And then, of course, we usually have most of the entertainment groups that come through the city as well. So everybody from the Rolling Stones and Bon Jovi to Sir Paul McCartney last year, Liberace from back in the 70s, the former president of France, François Mitterrand, Bill Clinton, and just about everybody else you can think of that's come through the city, that they've all stopped here. The hotel was called the Jewel of the Prairies when it was opened, and I really think it has maintained that look and feel. It's very elegant. It has the feel of a bygone era in a way. Having said that, it's very modern and contemporary in its services and what it provides, but it's just a very different experience. It's not your cookie cutter hotel by any means. You come here, you do get a feeling almost of stepping back in time, and we hope that combined with the service we provide, you get a feeling that you're in a royal place. You feel very special in coming here.
Thank you. What happens across Western Canada, it gets hit with a double whammy. There's an unbelievable drop in commodity prices, and that's the real root of the depression. A lot of people think it's the drought. The drought simply compounds the situation. So if you take a province like Saskatchewan, where 7 out of 10 people work in agriculture, whether it's farmers or working in the grain handling, grain marketing business, or supply and wholesale, et cetera, or even simply as farm labor. When the farm economy is clobbered, these people lose their jobs. And being single, a lot of them leave home because they don't want to be a burden to their family. And the cities at the time decide that they cannot support single men because there's such a large drain on relief funds. And so they decide only support married men. So a lot of these single homeless guys take to the road in search of work, in search of a future. That's who we're talking about. And many of them are very young, just out of school, and many of them didn't finish school because they wanted to get out and get a job to help their families, help their friends or whatever. And so they face a hard luck future. These were relief camp workers that went on strike in British Columbia because they felt not only had they been ignored, but the system had brutalized them. With the support of the communists who sent in organizers into these camps, they decided to go on strike, to strike for better conditions, to strike for basic rights. And they walked out of the camps in the spring of 1935 and descended upon Vancouver. And so when it appeared that the strike was about to break down because it had been going on for several weeks, somebody came up with the bright idea of taking their grievances directly to Ottawa, directly to the Prime Minister. So it's come to be called the On to Ottawa Trek, but one way of thinking of it is of a giant finger pointing from Western Canada to Ottawa, saying to Ottawa, single homeless unemployed men are your responsibility. You have to do something about it, and we're coming to tell you about our story, and we want action.
By the time the trekkers reach Regina, they have a pretty good idea that that's going to be that, at least as far as the federal government's concerned, that's going to be the end of it. But they put on a bold face. They're here for the weekend. The plan is to do what they'd done the weekend before in Calgary, arrive on Friday, leave on Monday, have a tag day, try to drum up public support for their cause, recruit more members, be out on the train on Monday morning.
Saskatchewan reacted to the trek in two ways. The official position is that they didn't want the trekkers stopping in Regina. There was a Liberal Premier, Jimmy Gardner. He felt that this was the doing of a Conservative Prime Minister, R.B. Bennett. This was his problem, and he was dumping his problem in Regina by stopping the trek there. In fact, Gardner warned the federal government that there was going to be trouble if they stopped this trek in Regina. He predicted violence. The trek was led by Arthur Slim Evans, who was a communist organizer. In fact, a very good communist organizer, very inspiring. And in fact, the men on the trek would have done anything for Slim Evans. So he's the leader. The trek itself has a military-like organization. There are divisions. The divisions are led by captains or marshals. And the trek leaders make it very clear when the men leave Vancouver that they'll get nowhere without organization and discipline. So when they arrive in a town, they don't dismount from the freight train unless given the order to. They march in four abreast into towns in unison. They sing songs, and in fact, they're very well behaved. The trekkers were in Regina for 2 weeks before the trouble erupted. And they were in Regina peaceably. The authorities had predicted that these men would get violent eventually because they had to be true to their revolutionary principles. And that's what the authorities were saying all along. But for 2 weeks, the trekkers realized that they're under the careful watch of the RCMP. If they stepped out of line, they would be crushed. And so they were a very peaceful group and did what they could to avoid drawing any attention to their situation that might result in violence.
Plan A is to arrest the trek leaders at Unity Center, the headquarters of one of the unemployed organizations in Regina, the more left-wing one, called the Regina Union of Unemployed. They had offices in a small building just around the corner from Market Square. And that was where the leadership of the trek met to discuss strategy. Well, this seemed to be a good idea. They could scoop these guys up. They often met there. It was thought they might meet there before the rally that was to begin at 8 o'clock that night at Market Square, so they'd scoop them up while they were meeting in Unity Center. Trouble was, they weren't there. Plan B was to arrest the Trek leaders who were present at the beginning of the public meeting in Market Square, and that's what they did. And it was to be a combined RCMP and city police project. The role of the city police was to act as a reserve, or at least that was Wood's understanding of the plan. The police would hide inside the garage at the rear of the city police station, which was also located on Market Square, and Wood intended that they would be held in reserve and they'd be summoned by a blast on a whistle. The Trekkers and the supporters of the Trekkers who tried to drive out of Regina on the Thursday night, they'd all been arrested and transported to Depot Division in a big furniture van. So three of these furniture vans pull up on the three open sides of the square containing mounted police inside with metal helmets on and billy clubs and all that stuff.
The rally was attended by the Trek leaders, quite a few of the Trekkers, but some of them stayed behind at the stadium to watch a ball game. But the majority of people are Regina citizens, and it's a holiday. So you got to realize this is before television, okay? So this is a popular event. This is a form of entertainment. Let's go out and see what the latest chapter in the saga of the Trekkers is going to be. So that's why they're on Market Square. And so you've got men, women, and children there on the square, and it's a peaceful rally. And so this filled otherwise empty lives on Dominion Day, and it was a peaceful rally in which people were being asked upon yet again to provide money so these Trekkers could leave Regina.
All hell breaks loose. The police rush the flatbed truck and take away Arthur Evans and another Trek leader. Some in the crowd run away from the square as the police make their way through the crowd. Some of them find rocks and pieces of wood and bricks and whatever to begin throwing them at the police. The police throw tear gas bombs back at the crowd.
They went in with whistles blowing, batons in the ready, and more or less stormed this peaceful rally. And so naturally, they got violence in return.
In any event, a riot breaks out on Market Square. A pitched battle is fought between the people on the square, some of whom are Trekkers, but the majority of whom are not, and the RCMP and the city police. And this pitched battle lasts for some time, and by the end of it, there's tear gas in the air everywhere. It was a terrible scene.
It turned into an armed combat, and in fact, eventually, the Regina City Police, one group, were backed up against the wall. It's after dark. They've got missiles coming in on them. They can't see the missiles coming in on them. They're getting hit. And so they're ordered to draw their service revolvers. The first time they fire over the crowd, the second time they fire into them. So, you know, the Regina City Police actually shoot at rioting Trekkers and citizens of Regina.
The gunshot wounds are all from the police revolvers. North of 11th Avenue on Cornwall Street was where the RCMP town station was. The RCMP has a presence in downtown Regina in addition to Depot Division out on the city's western outskirts. And the Trekkers and the others who are part of this group that have been running along 11th Avenue from Market Square into downtown Regina, they begin to congregate around the town station. Anyway, the crowd gathers, and one of the RCMP sergeants comes out of the town station and orders the crowd to disperse, and when they don't, he pulls his revolver out and fires a shot in the air, and then they begin to depart. And that was the only time during the course of the evening that a member of the RCMP actually fired his revolver.
The Trekkers were unarmed except for whatever they found on the streets of Regina. So they had rocks, they had bricks, they had bottles, they had wood. They threw at the police whatever they could get their hands on, and they didn't worry about doing damage themselves. So it was quite brutal.
Part of the crowd proceeded west along 11th Avenue into downtown Regina and fought a succession of pitched battles with the city police and the RCMP, some of the RCMP were on foot, others were on horseback, that lasted until late into the evening. Well, they threw things at the police. They pulled streetcars off their, and pushed cars into the street to create barricades, and then threw rocks over top like archers did in the Middle Ages. to knock the police off their horses or to slow down the advance of the city police and the RCMP. It's a battle.
It's like a war zone. This is street to street, building to building combat. Anything goes. Yes, the police have guns. They have their batons. They have their protective gear. But they're also facing groups or mobs. You could call them mobs roaming the streets of Regina, looking to extract a measure of revenge for what happened at Market Square.
And in the course of that, of course, a Regina City Police detective is murdered by persons as yet to this day unknown, hit over the head. And he was a World War I veteran, and he'd suffered an injury in France, and he had a metal plate put in his head. And he was hit with something and died shortly afterwards. Charles Miller.
There is another death. It happens several weeks later. There's a trekker caught on an open lot during the riot. He's got a rock in either hand, and a policeman comes up to him and hits him about the head and causes extensive brain damage. He's temporarily held in custody at the Regina jail. Then he's transferred to, the police jail. Then he's transferred to the Regina jail, where he's held in custody. His condition steadily deteriorates. He can't get out of bed. He can't get his balance. He's about to die, and before he dies, he's sent to hospital, and it's in hospital that he dies.
But there's very little thievery. Windows are broken, but nothing is stolen. Maybe this is this military kind of discipline.
The provincial government steps in and immediately begins negotiations with the trekkers to disband the trek, and they have a choice. They can go back to the camp that they originally came from, or they could go to their home community. So it's the province that steps in. It's the province that provides food for these men on July 2nd and afterwards. It's the province that provides transportation out of Regina. And so it's under provincial auspices that the trek is really disbanded.
In some ways, the trek shares a lot in common with a tornado that devastated parts of Regina on June 30th, 1912. The physical legacy are these plaques and the memory of Reginans who are old enough to remember that event, and the way in which it's become a symbol for the left in Canada of a time of hard times for Canadians and a time when the federal government seemed completely unsympathetic to the plight of working people. It's way out of left field, this idea. So the group of men traveled on the top of boxcars through the mountains, across the prairies, through northern Ontario to Ottawa, to vent their grievances to the Prime Minister. If that isn't a wildcat idea, what is? I suppose if Bennett had dithered, although he wasn't the kind of guy to dither, if Bennett had dithered, they would have stopped the trek in Winnipeg as the best of a bad lot. But he was determined to do it as quick as he could in the place that made the most sense, and that's Regina. And so Regina has its 15 minutes of fame.
The mainstream press at the time of the 1930s, they're conservative papers, they're liberal papers. So the Regina Leader Post, which was a liberal paper, condemned the R.B. Bennett government. And that's true with most liberal papers during the 1930s. The conservative press, on the other hand, supported R.B. Bennett and what he did. I think what papers all political persuasions did is that they were more or less appalled by what happened on the streets of Regina, that the people in Regina that night, whether police, trekkers or citizens, had acted in an uncharacteristic Canadian way, and that it was embarrassing and it was a dark mark on Canadian history. The long-term legacy of the Regina riot and the Ottawa trek is that those same people that were mad as hell and wanted to tell R.B. Bennett that he should take responsibility for them and do something for them, these were the same individuals come 1939 that fought for King and country. And that's a sad irony here. They never turned their backs on this country the way they felt that the Prime Minister did to their own situation. They were willing to fight for Canada and to sacrifice their life for Canada, and many of them did.
Thank you. Welcome to the Co-op Refinery Complex, one of Canada's largest petroleum refineries. Our more than 1,000 permitted employees produce 130,000 barrels of premium finished petroleum products per day. While the majority of the refinery's production is gasoline and diesel, the facility also produces propane, butane, anode-grade coke, heavy fuel oil, asphalt, and sulfur. The Co-op Refinery Complex produces 6.8 billion liters of finished products per year and has 5.6 million barrels of storage on site. On average, the refinery distributes 17 million liters of product each and every day, supplying the cooperative retailing system with fuel they require to serve the Western Canadian market. The co-op sells approximately 8.2 million liters of gasoline a day. The Co-op Refinery Complex is made up of five processing sections that sit on over 800 acres of land on the north end of the city of Regina. Sections 1 and 2 are the oldest sections on site, and in conjunction with Section 3, process up to 60,000 barrels per day of heavy crude through Crude Unit Number 1. In Sections 1 and 2, crude is converted into high-quality gasoline and some diesel. The first two sections served the refinery by themselves for over 30 years, from the mid-1950s until 1987. In the late 1970s, a major revamp where most of Section 1 was replaced brought capacity to 50,000 barrels per day of sweet crude. Section 3 was added in 1988 as a partnership with the Saskatchewan provincial government that added the heavy oil upgrader and the ability to process 100% heavy crude at 60,000 barrels per day. The heavy oil upgrader provided the refinery with the advantage of processing Saskatchewan-produced heavy crude, benefiting both the province and the refinery. Section 3 also added increased diesel production of higher quality, allowing the refinery to make premium diesel. Together, Sections 1, 2, and 3 make up the majority of the refinery's physical footprint. Section 4 of the refinery processes 40,000 barrels per day of sour synthetic crude, with the majority converted to the highest quality premium diesel in the market. This diesel serves the cooperative retailing system as they help our Western Canadian agriculture producers to fuel seeding, harvest, and the needs of their operations. Diesel is a large part of our operation. In order to meet the demands of the Western Canadian market, the Co-op Refinery Complex is configured and has the flexibility to produce gasoline and diesel at a 1-to-1 ratio. Section 5 is the most recent addition to our operation, opening for business in the fall of 2012. The $2.8 billion expansion processes 30,000 barrels per day of sweet synthetic crude. With the addition of this section, the refinery's processing capacity of crude oil is increased from 100,000 to 130,000 barrels per day. The newest section to the refinery also included revamps to existing units, and combined with Section 5, added 40,000 barrels per day increase in gasoline and diesel production. Section 6 is the process area that constitutes steam production, pumps, storage tanks, and our water and wastewater systems. In the spring of 2016, the refinery announced that its industry-leading $200 million wastewater improvement project was in its commissioning phase. The project makes the CRC the only refinery in North America that can clean and recycle all of its wastewater for the purpose of steam production. This puts the CRC on the leading edge of environmental sustainability in the oil refining industry and ensures a greener future for the refinery and the community. In addition to the five crude processing sections, the refinery also has its own on-site maintenance, with more than 300 employees working to maintain the facility. In addition, safety personnel, emergency response teams, and an on-site fire department keep the refinery, the community, and the refinery employees safe. An on-site laboratory works daily to ensure product quality, as the refinery goes to great lengths to deliver the finest quality petroleum products in the industry. The refinery's Petroleum Distribution Department, or PDD, is responsible for the loading and transportation of the refinery's products. This department also manufactures and ships the lube oils for the cooperative retailing system. Finally, many on-site engineering and administration functions, ensure our equipment is operational and our business is operating effectively and efficiently. At the Co-op Refinery Complex, our vision is to be a recognized leader in safety, reliability, and sustainability within the petroleum refining industry. We believe our values of integrity, responsibility, and excellence will guide us in realizing our vision and ultimately fuel our business in accomplishing our mission of fueling Western Canada.
Is a very special year around the University of Regina. It's our anniversary, and we are celebrating 100 years of excellence in education. The university's origins can be traced to 1911, when a group of publicly spirited citizens established Regina College, a residential high school founded by the Methodist Church. In 1934, Regina College became a junior college of the University of Saskatchewan. In 1959, the institution became a second campus of the University of Saskatchewan and was elevated to full degree-granting status. On July 1, 1961, the college was renamed the University of Saskatchewan Regina Campus. By an act of legislation in 1974, the Regina Campus became the University of Regina, a fully independent university. Throughout 2011, there will be a number of special initiatives to commemorate our centennial, and I'm pleased to introduce one of them now. Throughout the year, Dr. James Pizzula will be presenting Centennial Moments, a look back on some of the stories that have shaped our incredible history over the past century. Join me in celebrating this University of Regina milestone and 100 years of excellence in education.
The first serious talk about Regina College being established was in June of 1909. That's when the Methodist Conference in Saskatchewan said, why don't we start a residential college in Regina? And keep in mind that many of these church colleges evolve into universities. Like if you look at Queen's University, it was a Presbyterian college. University of Winnipeg was a Methodist college. Brandon University started out as a Baptist college. So when they're talking about starting a church college, there's always in the back of people's minds the idea that this can potentially evolve into something else. And if you look at our leader post, actually it was called the Leader then, in 1912, it's actually in the real estate edition, so you can tell that they're thinking in business terms. But they say that this Regina College is potentially the University of Southern Saskatchewan. This is not something we impose on the past. You know, we're constructing this continuous narrative of the history of an institution from 1911 to now. They already had that in their minds. And in June of 1909, that's 2 months after the decision was made by the Board of Governors of the University of Saskatchewan to locate the university in Saskatoon. So they're already thinking in Regina about some kind of option for Regina and surrounding areas. The charter for the Regina College was provided by the Government of Saskatchewan in April of 1911. And then the first classes were held that fall. There were actually 27 students enrolled in the first term, but that grew as the year went on because more and more people from outside Regina, especially in the rural areas, sort of leapt at the opportunity that they could actually continue their education. Because there were no high schools, very few high schools in rural Saskatchewan at that time. And then the official opening was in the fall of 1912, and that's when the Governor General, the Duke of Connaught, with his wife and daughter, Princess Patricia, came and they officially opened the college. So you could say by 1912, you really had the college founded. You had a building, that main building that's still there on College Avenue. You had land. They bought 23 acres, paid $2,000 an acre for it from the provincial government right along Wascana Lake there. And they had a kind of a mission. They had decided on their motto, as one who serves, and it was something they really meant. There was a new compulsory course in human relations that the first principal introduced. Every student had to take it. They, in addition to their academic program, they had to take this class about quote-unquote human relations, which they meant by that all kinds of social issues, all kinds of contemporary social issues that were going on at that time. The students were expected to know about that and to be encouraged to take some responsibility for making Canada a better place in the face of these various problems of rapid growth, immigration, urbanization, poverty, all these things that were happening at that time. By 1940, the University of Saskatchewan had taken ownership of Regina College. So they were responsible, they appointed the administrators, they ran the college, did everything in connection with examinations and so forth. And they also made the decision, that they being the University of Saskatchewan, that there would only be grade 12 and the first year university courses offered. So this meant that Regina College was somewhat limited in its potential for growth because it was also the policy not to allow more than the first year to be taught at Regina College, even though it was now part of the University of Saskatchewan. So enrollment was declining. And in 1940, the Royal Canadian Air Force looked at the buildings and they thought they would be ideal for an initial air training center. So they went to the university and they asked for the buildings and the campus, excluding Dark Hall, by the way. Dark Hall was still going to be used by the Conservatory of Music. And the university said yes, the RCAF could have Regina College for its training purposes during the war. So it became what was called an initial air training school. That meant that the new recruits would come for 4 weeks and they would get basic training. There was a Link trainer, which is like a simulated aircraft, so they could practice, pretend they were flying. They did aptitude tests. They decided who should be a pilot, who should be a gunner, who should be a navigator. And then after that 4 week training period, they would go to whatever school would specialize in that type of training. So basically you had 500 new recruits going through Regina College every month, 6,000 a year, up until the end of 1944, when they decided the war was going to be won and they didn't need any more air crew, any more new air crew. So that was how Regina College was given over to the Air Force for most of the Second World War, and it was interpreted in the community as a sacrifice. You will find letters and editorials in the Leader Post by that time, and they were saying, well, good for Regina College, you know, we owe you one, type of thing, because they felt that there should be some compensation for that. Now, there's another part to this story that I think is very important. Is the issue came up, where do we relocate? And the initial decision by the university was to put Regina College, what was left of Regina College, into an elementary school called Benson Elementary School, which was now Luther High School, close to the RCMP barracks. In other words, way out in the at the edge of the city. And also, there were already elementary school children in the elementary school. So there would be no separation of the two schools. In fact, they'd use the same washroom facilities. And the dean of Regina College said this was totally unacceptable. He said it could even kill Regina College, because who would want to go there? So what they did was, there was a tremendous effort in the community. And you can see by this time, the city council, some United Church ministers, some groups representing young people, they sort of rallied behind the college and they said, well, this is an important institution for us. We don't want it stuck away in an elementary school somewhere at the edge of town. So they were able to get the Regina Trading Company building, which was a solid, substantial, four-story building at the corner of Scarth and 12th Avenue. It's actually where, on the northeast corner, where one of the Hill Towers is now. So this was a more prestigious location. And it showed that the Regina College was an important place with a future. And so actually the spirit of the school was fairly high. Even in the student body, you get a sense of that with things the students are saying and doing. Even though enrollment was at a low ebb, especially when many of the men and some of the women volunteered for the armed forces. So that's how we get through the war. You know, the building serves a useful purpose. The building and the grounds serve a useful purpose for the Air Force. And at the same time, some of the momentum of the college is not lost, because it has a fairly desirable place to go during the time that it's not in its own location. Well, I think the Regina campus was caught up in the social activism of the 60s, in part because it was a brand new place. It was tabula rasa. And therefore, there was no well-established conservative tradition, which in some of the older universities was a counterbalance to kind of experimentation or social innovation that was taking place at the Regina campus. And you have to give the students a lot of credit for this. The students were really taking the lead in this. And I think it's partly the sort of the political heritage of the province, and this is the capital city, so the political heritage of the province would be very much felt here because of our history of the Depression and the need to build an economy that's based on resources that has some degree of stability to it. There has always been a particular political tradition here of trying to figure out solutions that will work and not necessarily solutions that are applicable to Central Canada or other parts of Canada. Medicare, as you know, was here, and that was 1962. So that's right in the midst of this. And students were debating Medicare. Like, they were having mock parliamentary debates and they were talking about it. And actually, if you're talking about how the University of Regina came into existence, the students were in the lead for the campaign to have an independent university. They were actually ahead of the faculty in that respect, because there was a demonstration in March of 1964 and they marched to the legislature and they had two issues. One was tuition fees. The tuition fees had gone up $50, so now they were about like $300 a year, which was considered way too high. And the second issue was autonomy for the Regina campus. So they were asking for that well ahead of any university body because they felt that University of Regina could create its own destiny more successfully as an independent institution. Certainly Regina campus had the reputation for being the hotbed of this type of social activism. And in part that was deserved. I think it's maybe a little bit overstated because there was a certain amount of social activism in Saskatoon as well. Like I was a student there, so I remember it. But it wasn't as salient, it wasn't as prominent, it wasn't as well publicized as it was here on the Regina campus. And partly was the Carillon, which was a very good newspaper, a very good student newspaper, one of the best in the country. And so it attracted a lot of attention. The Globe and Mail used to pick up articles from the Carillon. It took the lead on the Aboriginal issue. It was ahead of the Leader Post on stories having to do with the position of Indian and Métis people in Saskatchewan. It did high quality investigative journalism. So there is no doubt that there is a difference between Regina and Saskatoon in terms of the mood of the 60s. But I don't want to make it black and white. I think that they're both places had a certain amount of this social activism. But Regina, because of the fact that it was a brand new place, and it wasn't anchored by professional faculties of long standing. Like if you look at the universities across the country in the 60s, the most socially active ones, the most activist ones, were not the older, well-established ones because they had an inherent built-in conservatism to their history. So it's not surprising at all that on a brand new campus, a brand new student body, you'd find a little bit more of this openness to change than you would find in a longer established place. There was always in the university, though, a mixture. It wasn't all radical. There was always a tension between the more conservative and the more adventurous elements within the university. So it's an oversimplification to say that this was just a hotbed of 60s radicalism and that's all. It wasn't just one thing or the other. Well, when we talk about President Lloyd Barber, we're actually talking about my own lived history. Most of the work I've done on the history of Regina, I've read documents in the archives about, have no personal knowledge of. But when I came to the university, Lloyd Barber was the president, so I kind of have that kind of information about him, in addition to the archival research I've done on that era. But it strikes me that it's easy to run a university when there's lots of money, and it's very hard to run a university when money is short. And what happened after the boom of the 60s and the early 70s is that suddenly money was very short.
I was a vice president of the University of Saskatchewan, which meant both universities. So I had a great deal to do with splitting the budget between the two, with personnel matters between the two, and I thought there were some great efficiencies in the relationship. But when it became inevitable that they were going to split, I resigned my position and stood down because I didn't want to be part of the process of the division. When John Archer, who was the first president in Regina, stood down, I was asked to put my name in for the presidency and became the second president and began the process of building an institution that was badly lacking in many of the basic services which had previously been done. It was a long, long pull to help create a new independent institution. people don't realize, because of the difficult economic circumstances and because of the history of the two institutions, how close the University of Regina was to being wound down by people who thought it might not succeed. Fascinating when I learned later of real concerns in the government that the University of Regina might not succeed. So I don't know how active the forces against it were, but they were there. And we had no champions in the government because we had no graduates who were in either the bureaucracy or the on the political side. And we couldn't get anything built. We couldn't get any capital. The roof leaked and the phone didn't work. It was hopeless. I had to put plastic bags on my desk to keep my papers from getting wet when it rained overnight. We had to import parts for the phone system from Mexico because the phone system was so obsolete. The only place they had any parts left was Mexico. And we couldn't get any capital to do to fix that kind of stuff because maybe we weren't going to continue in existence. Those were not easy times, I tell you.
I think he himself used to say, well, I'm a builder. And there is truth to that, because even when money was short, he reallocated funds to start new programs. Saskatchewan Indian Federated College, journalism. And so that the university kept growing. It didn't lose its sort of forward momentum. It would have been easy to sort of cave and despair at that point. Because we live in a sort of a boom and bust world in Saskatchewan. And you have to have the long view to see that if things are a little bit tough, it's no time to sort of start tearing things down. You have to keep on going in the confidence that things will improve, as they did eventually. One of the achievements of President Barber was that he took us through those years without a diminution of confidence. Again, I think personality comes into play. I also think his basic instincts were almost always right in terms of what really matters in a university, you know, what the underlying values of liberal education are. That is to say, respect for the truth, respect for other people's point of view, civil dialogue. Even if you don't agree with what another scholar is saying, you have to treat them decently. And similarly, even if you don't agree with what a student is saying, you have to respect that they are an individual, they have the right to their opinion. I think that's a core value of university education, and I always felt that President Barber was always on the right side of that issue.
Mankind has an innate curiosity to find out how and why, and universities have been institutions that have been somewhat apart from the society where people were given the privilege of searching for how and why.
George Barr was a very interesting man. He was a lawyer in the city, quite a high-profile lawyer. He had argued cases before the Privy Council in London. And he had a sort of a bee in his bonnet. He felt very strongly that Regina College should extend its offerings from just the first year to the full 3 years of a BA. That time a BA degree took 3 years. And at the time, he wasn't really a very popular figure. At first, he was a voice in the wilderness. The sort of establishment families in Regina were not really of the view that this was the time for a full university degree. Some of the more prosperous families could well afford to send their children to university outside of Regina, maybe University of Toronto, University of Manitoba, perhaps University of Saskatchewan. So that wasn't really an issue for the very wealthiest people in the city. But Barr was more concerned with sort of the average family. And it was partly his life story, because he came from a poor background himself. He was from a farm in Ontario. He had a marvelous teacher in the country school. And he credited all the success he had in life to that educational opportunity. He said he wouldn't be arguing cases before the Privy Council in London if he hadn't had that good educational start. He and his wife were very involved in the community. They were in every organization that was going. They were totally committed to the culture and the social and development of Regina society. He was involved in all kinds of organizations, a real community-minded man. And so he saw this as an extension of that, the development of higher education in Regina. And he just thought it was a scandal that so many young people of ability were not going to university because their families couldn't afford it. And actually, if you look at the statistics, they bear him out, because the university participation rate for Saskatchewan was well below the national average in the 1950s. On the average in Canada, 7.2% of high school graduates went on to university. In Saskatchewan, it was only 4.1%. So Barr said that part of this was because of the structure of the university system. Remember, Regina was still the larger city. Regina had about 83,000 people in the mid-50s. Saskatoon had about 66,000. So his whole argument was focused on this opportunities for youth theme that he developed. And he got allies along the way. Father Athol Murray, the president at Notre Dame College in Wilcox, was very much of the same view. And he basically said, shame on the province for not giving more opportunities for young people to advance their education. And at that time, Ross Thatcher, who's later premier, he was a member of parliament for the CCF in Moose Jaw. He was an advocate of a full degree program in Regina. So gradually, as George Barr kept beating this drum, more and more people came to his side. So it actually was not from within the university, not within the college, that the campaign originated. It was from the community itself. And what Barr did was he persuaded the mayor to hold a public meeting at City Hall. About 150 people attended, and they formed the Regina College Citizens Committee. And they had representatives from the Trades and Labor Council, from the Chamber of Commerce, from the Home and Schools Association, from the Royal Canadian Legion, a broad-based coalition of citizens who were all saying increasingly loudly by the late 1950s that the time had come for university expansion in Regina. Like, maybe you could argue in 1911 that the province couldn't afford two universities, but the time had come, with the baby boomers especially starting to be of an age where they needed a university education, that the demographic pressures were strong. So I see George Barr as a kind of an interesting character, because it's interesting when somebody speaks out and says what other people don't yet believe, but eventually they are persuaded of the view. And I just like his sort of eccentricity, his orneriness, that he kept on talking about this when people were saying, oh, just please be quiet about that, we don't want to deal with that right now. But he was just so persistent and so sort of in your face. And he was an old man by this time too. He was well into his 70s when he started this. Perhaps he felt, well, I have nothing to lose. I don't care what people say about me. Rocking the boat a little bit. But anyway, when the decision was made in 1959 by the University of Saskatchewan to establish a full degree program in Regina, there was a big editorial in the Regina Leader that said, Regina rejoices at the news, and we give credit to George Barr. And they even said something like, and his wife Ethel, because they held the torch, they said, in the darkest hours, you know, as though they'd been with him all the time. But he was the one that was persisting in calling this a major issue that had to be dealt with.
Hi, I'm Kelly Koskaden for Tourism Saskatchewan, and I'm standing over beautiful Wascana Lake. This is a man-made lake going through the center of Regina. There's beautiful parks all around us.
Quiet green spaces, all the appeals of nature, but all the amenities of city living too at the same time.
Regina is the second largest city in Saskatchewan, but is the province's capital. Also the home of the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and the home of the RCMP Training Academy.
What you saw today was actually called the Sergeant Major's Parade. This parade is every week, Monday to Friday, every lunch hour. When this started way back with the Northwest Mounted Police, and we just carried it on because it is a heritage. It's been part of our tradition since the beginning of the Northwest Mounted Police. It is a fantastic place to visit. We just love them when the public comes. The biggest thing I would tell people is that definitely go to the Heritage Center. And once you've seen the Heritage Center, you have to come and have a tour on base. And it really brings it all together. You can really see the heritage.
We were at the Heritage Center, and they really enjoyed the video and seeing all of that. And the inside of this was really cool as well.
So now that we've seen the pomp and pageantry of the Sergeant Major's Parade, I'm going to go into the Heritage Center and find out more about the 135 years of history of the RCMP.
This is one of two of the original cannons that were taken on the March West. They were pulled by Arabian horses, and they were nicknamed the Horse Killer, not because they killed horses with them, but because they were very heavy. These cannons weighed about 4,000 pounds, and you can imagine dragging these across the prairies was very hard for the horses to do. Once the RCMP reached up north, they realized it was very different from when they were out west. So the Inuit people in the area showed them ways and tools to survive. We have some snow blindness goggles. We also have very warm mukluks, also made by Inuit people to help them survive.
I'm from Digby, Nova Scotia. The chapel, which I thought was a fantastic site. And the presentation is very, very well done.
It's changed a lot for the better.
It was an excellent tour of the center.
I first started here at the Globe when I was 17 as a cast member in the Fusion Project.
Back when I was in about grade 4 or 5, my mom found this
Globe Theatre School and thought maybe it'd be interesting for me to get involved with.
My first year was 6 years ago that I started. It's a great atmosphere for kids.
My mom used to bring me to the Globe Theatre, and I remember actually sitting in the balcony in the Center of the Arts when they were there. I started as a patron and then had an opportunity to become involved in the board. From there, I saw the increasingly important role that the Globe Theatre played in our communities.
The Globe provides a huge opportunity for playwrights, for actors, for sound people, for stage performers, for choreographers, for dancers. And that's what the Globe is about, providing opportunity to our community.
The partnership between the University of Regina and the Globe is very unique. The Globe, for us, is an important partner. They hire a number of our students. They provide internships for our students, both in theater and production, but also in business. And we have a fabulous co-op program, and this is one of the places we love to place our students.
After I finished my undergrad degree in acting at the U of R, I considered going someplace else and studying more. And the opportunity came up to do a main stage production here. And that's really what kept me here, the opportunity to work professionally, which doesn't happen that often for new graduates. And since then, I've been given a lot of opportunities to work not only as an actor, but also develop and hone skills as a director and a creator and as a teacher.
I didn't do any theater at all through most of my 20s. I'd done some in high school, and then around the time I turned 30, I moved to a town in Saskatchewan where I was working as a reporter and got involved with the local community theater groups there, and just felt this awakening inside me, you know, like, why have I waited? Why did I wait this long to do this again? And eventually it got to the point where I thought, I want to do more of this. I want to learn how to do it better. You can have all the belief in the world in yourself and in your abilities, but until you find those people who will say yes and give you the chance, it's difficult. You can feel like you're banging your head against a wall. And I found a family here with the Globe. I found a group of people who understand what that is inside that has you doing this crazy work. And that has made the difference.
Riley, my son, worked here at the Globe Theatre 2 summers in a row. And I always say very openly and very honestly that if it was not for his experience here at the Globe Theatre, his road in life would have been a little bit more bumpy. He was making some unhealthy choices in life, and his experience and exposure here to the Globe Theatre, to the staff, and to the things that he worked on really helped steer him onto a healthier road, into a better path. Basically, in a nutshell, it really saved his life.
When I joined the Globe Theatre Board of Directors, I wasn't surprised to see that the organization was very sound creatively, but what surprised me was the strength of the business, how well run this business was, and how, in fact, from a business perspective, it was really one of the best run theaters in all of Canada.
When I was the chair of the board, I used to attend PAC meetings, which were the national theater meetings. And so for me, seeing the esteem in which Globe Theater was held on a national basis was very important to me. And it really gives you context for how the theater fits into the national scene. And certainly Globe Theatre is a player.
From a box office perspective, the business had grown almost 200% in a period of about a decade, which was absolutely amazing. We're playing to capacity, which every other theatre in Canada, even during these difficult economic times, couldn't say that they were doing. And if you look at this year alone, we've added 1,000 subscribers. So is this part of the new Regina, where we have the possibilities to make this city something fantastic? Absolutely.
The partnership with the Globe is a win-win. It is a win-win because culture, art, dance, drama, music, that's the heartbeat of our community. And any business or educational organization wants to be connected to the heartbeat.
When you go to the Globe, you see a show that makes you do a little bit of thinking about the nature of who we are.
The Globe's got to be commended because in Canada, it's a jewel, it's a gem, because it's the only place in the round. It's a fantastic place to come and watch live theater.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
Science and technology in our century. Never before has the world seen such progress in so short a time. Progress that has left the layman blinking with confusion in a bewildering new world of computers, atomic energy, space travel, and microwave ovens. For many, science has become not only incomprehensible, but a little frightening as well.
Hi, I'm David Suzuki. You know, the laws of science act on us everywhere. For example, gravity is pulling this skateboard. Friction is keeping me on. My muscles and nerves help me coordinate, and optics let me see where I'm going. That's what a science center is all about, a place where kids and grown-ups, too, can explore the exciting world of science firsthand. Come on and find out.
It is to demonstrate and expand upon these principles that the concept of a science center has evolved. In June 1978, the Regina Junior League presented a proposal which had been researched for over a year. The proposal called for the establishment of a Saskatchewan Science Center as a joint project of the Junior League and the Saskatchewan Power Corporation. The proposed site was to be the old Regina Power Plant in Wascana Park. Although slated to be torn down, the historic old structure would provide an ideal home for the new center. Built to last and beautifully located across from the waterfowl sanctuary in Wascana Park, the building offered a potential of 48,000 square feet of space for exhibits and displays. To support their proposal, the League initiated an extensive public relations program to stimulate public awareness and reaction. In June 1979, the League sponsored a science circus put on by the Ontario Science Center. Over 15,000 people crowded the old power plant for the 10-day event. The League also completed a project information booth, which was used in a number of public locations. Visitor response left no doubt that the people of Saskatchewan were ready for their own science center. A Science Center task force was formed to compile feasibility studies, cost estimates, and recommendations and reports from experts in the field. As a result of these efforts, the provincial cabinet approved $3 million in capital expenditures for further development. The Saskatchewan Science Center will utilize some of the best ideas from science museums all over the world, plus exhibits particularly suited to our province. Saskatchewan's interest in resources such as grain, coal, and potash will be considered in designing the center. The overall concept will be that of a hands-on approach to learning, with participational exhibits and exploring environments. Props and apparatus, which visitors can work themselves, will demonstrate the natural phenomena of basic science. These will be supplemented by historical and static displays showing the development of science and its roots in the past. Ultimately, in addition to exhibit and demonstration areas, the center will include activity areas designed specifically for the children and for science fairs, presentation areas for the showing of slides and films, and even a small store allowing visitors to take a small part of their experience home with them. A bonus feature of the power plant location will be the affiliation of the Science Center with SPC's Research and Development Center, which adjoins the old building. its laboratories and test centers may provide visitors an opportunity to glimpse actual research underway. For people of all ages, especially our children, the Saskatchewan Science Center will provide a learning environment that is fun and exciting.
There's a building right over there. Oh, no! No! I never could skateboard and talk at the same time. It's sobering to realize that today's youngsters will spend most of their lives in the 21st century. Theirs will be a world of computers, space exploration, and genetic engineering. A science center would be one of the finest ways to help them prepare for that world.
This front door shuts, you're in Europe 400 years ago. It was originally built by Francis Dark in 1926. We've created essentially a medieval castle. It's very interactive, so a lot of the guests that come on the tour get to lie in the bed, sit in the tubs, that kind of stuff.
We're in Regina.
It's all real stuff. These are all real paintings that are anywhere from 16th century to 19th century. A lot of people around here overlook stuff like that. We don't, you know, spend too much time thinking about castles because we're not known for our castles, and maybe now we will be.